For more, I'm joined by Maria de Los Angeles Torres, a Cuban-born American who's now a professor of Latin American and Latino studies and director of the center at the University of Illinois, Chicago. Her books include By Heart, De Memoria, Cuban Women's Journeys in and Out of Exile, and The Lost Apple, Operation Pedro Pan, Cuban Children in the U.S., and The Promise of a Better Future. Professor, Cuba's been a particularly tough place for its citizens to travel from for some time. If you stay out of the country for more than 11 months, you lose your right to residency, you lose your health care. Is this a big change?
I think it's a very significant change to the extent that this law, which was actually called the Law of Definitive Abandonment, a very Brave World, if you will, kind of description here. And the law prevented Cubans from returning if initially it was actually 60 days. The 11 months comes much later. But in 1961, if you left for whatever reason and did not return within 60 days, you lost your home, your property, and your right to be returned to your family. So many families really have been divided by this law. Now, having have said this, I think we need to really look at the overall context and perhaps maybe talk about what this law, what this change means, and what we could maybe glean in terms of the behind the scenes of a Cuban government.
Well, why now? What do you think prompts this change at this very moment?
I think, Ray, that there's a couple of readings of this. One, it is the change in policy itself shows that there's a lot of maneuvering behind the scenes. One reading could be that the Ministry of the Interior, which is the agency and the institution in charge of intelligence, as well as the control of populations coming in and out, is actually losing ground. So they will no longer have this power to be able to give exit visas to at least a broad section of the Cuban population. They have historically been at odds with the military being Raúl's, the Ministry of the Interior being more in the Fidel camp. We see this over and over again. There's also, I think, the coincidence of interest between ideologues and pragmatists. The ideologues have always said, let them go, make it easy for them to go, because it purifies the nation. The pragmatists see this as a move towards aligning Cuba into what really the majority of the world, almost every country, does not have control people from leaving their country. So the pragmatists see this. I think, interestingly as well, one of the things that has happened in the last year, I mean, I think the government has changed laws to keep up with what was already going on the ground. And one of the things that has been happening is people do travel. They have passports. They have found grandmothers. They have found family members in Spain, Venezuela. So there's a lot of people who actually have passports. They still had to get their exit visa from the Cuban government. Now, what are these people doing? They're going abroad and they're bringing back goods. So in a certain sense, the new, if you will, the new economists are seeing this as a way of opening up trade and bringing and allowing for goods to flow into the country in ways that perhaps the embargo doesn't allow still.
As I mentioned earlier, there are going to be exceptions. It's written into the law that if you are part of the human capital created by the revolution, it's not going to be so easy to go. I assume that means people who are very well trained, whose skills are in demand.
Right. I mean, but that could be almost anybody. So again, the devil's always in the detail in these kinds of policies. But if those of us who read Cuban politics understand that a lot of these changes never happen dramatically. They happen very piecemeal. And behind these piecemeals, what you find really are very shifting kinds of factions and power struggles and distributions of power. So if we look at it that way, I think it at least raises the question, what's really behind this?
Raúl Castro came to the presidency in 2008 promising change. He held a national party congress to talk about it. Is this part of that trend?
Well, I think that Raúl's people, if you will, the military have a lot of them have been more on the pragmatic end of the spectrum, I think, in Cuban politics. And in many ways, what I think that we have seen is, on the one hand, the law and changes and policies catching up with what was already going on in the country. It's not so much changes that then allowed people to do these commerce and, you know, have their beauty parlors and their restaurants. I mean, that was already happening. So in a certain sense, they were keeping up with that. On the other hand, Raoul has also implemented a fairly draconian policy against human rights activists, as well as some of the people that were perceived to be enemies of his factions. I mean, this summer alone, there were arrests of very key government policy makers that worked with Ricardo Alarcón, for instance. We haven't heard that in the press. People who had been in charge of Cuba's policy towards the Cuban community were also arrested. Foreigners who were in charge of developing all the golf courses and the resorts in the Keys, they were also arrested. So I think that we have to be careful to not look at this as a big sweeping change, but rather understand that we will see certain changes that fulfill pragmatic needs of the government, that try to keep up with people, that try to keep discontent down at the same time that the control and security apparatus is still well and alive.
Professor Maria de Los Angeles Torres, good to talk to you.
You too, Ray.